the barn feels really different from up here. So I really appreciate you taking the time to listen. And I love you, Gabriella, for those kind words, but I don't know if I would say gracefully, because a lot of what you'll hear today is the moments in my life that maybe weren't so graceful and were much more difficult for me and maybe even my twin sister to handle than anyone could have ever imagined. So you'll hear most people, when they see me today as the confident person that I think I'm still growing into, the growing hasn't finished, but most people who see me today don't realize that although I was born with my physical disability, cerebral palsy, which is a lack of oxygen to the brain, so it is a brain injury as well, not similar to Kevin Pugh. It is a brain injury, but I've had mine since birth, and my twin sister is more severely disabled simply because I was born 9 minutes before her. Usually for twins, that's not typical. So she suffered a longer lack of oxygen to the brain, and that means she's nonverbal, and she uses a special device similar to the technology that Stephen Hawking uses to communicate. And it also means that she needs a little bit more assistance with activities of daily living, as do I. But what's so magical about who we are today is that when we were little, we didn't know that. We didn't know that we were any different from our brother and sister or anyone else we met on the street, for that matter. Or at least that was the way it was in our household. And one story that I always remember that I think reflects how little we knew of how different society saw us from the outside was when I was turning 5 years old. Our birthday is December 19th, and our brother, our oldest brother, Oliver, was born exactly a year and 2 days before us. So we were Christmas babies. And one day, the three of us were in a van coming back from another doctor's appointment. And my mom wanted to get our minds off of it. So she started asking us, you know, what do you want for Christmas? What do you want for your birthday? And so my brother answered, and I don't really remember what he asked for, but I remember looking at her and say, I was 4, so turning 5. My brother was 5, turning 6. And I just looked at my mom and I said, Mom, when I turn 6, like Oliver, will I be able to walk? And the reason why that happened is because we had just come from the first fitting appointment to get my very first wheelchair. I had gotten big enough and I was getting ready to go to school, and I needed to have a wheelchair in order to get onto the school bus. And my mom, when she told me that story as I got older, said that that was her first realization of how much we understood that even though we were all equal in our household, that something was a little bit different. And I actually spoke to her today to ask her to remind me how she responded to that. And she said that when I looked at her in that car and I asked if I'd be able to walk on my 6th birthday, she said she didn't want to destroy the illusion that we had of our life being just like Gabriella, just like Oliver, and all the rest of our friends and family, because in our circle of friends and family, when I tell you we really weren't any different, I mean it in every way you could imagine. We had chores, we got in trouble, we did everything that our family did. We went everywhere that our family went. There wasn't, I am who I am today because there wasn't anything that I wanted to do or dreamed of doing. And you'll hear a little bit about those crazy dreams today that my family said no to. And that applied to me and my more severely disabled twin sister, Alba, who I admire so much. I was in the womb with her, I've grown up with her, I'm closer to her than I am to anyone in the world. And I sit in such great admiration of her because of what she overcomes. Because even though we do have the same disability, it affects us differently. And that's another important message that I want to try to get across. I'm here talking to you today as me. I work with the disability community. I am a pretty well-known advocate because of all the amazing work that my mom has done. But I'm just here speaking about my experience. The disability community is very diverse. Just because you see another person in a wheelchair does not mean that they have cerebral palsy. And what I go through is very different than what someone like Kemet went through, who became disabled later in life after knowing what it was like to be able-bodied. And so someone with any other kind of spinal cord injury or degenerative disorder, like muscular dystrophy, they're all disabilities or illnesses or disorders that result in disability, but our experiences are different. So that's one of the things that I hope you take away from this talk today, is that to be curious about all of us. I do hope that you learn from my experience, but the best thing you can do for people like me is not to assume and not to be scared to ask, and to give us the same opportunities and considerations that you would anyone else, because believe me, we do have those same dreams. And another wonderful thing that my parents did is to teach me that my disability is a part of who I am. It's not everything that I am. My wheelchair, the other thing is people think about devices like this, wheelchairs, walkers, hearing aids. I feel like there's still such a negative connotation around all of these things, around the assistive devices that let us lead our lives. So that's the other thing I'm gonna say. I will really feel like we've made some massive changes in our society when my wheelchair is looked at as something that enables me rather than something that disables me, because that's exactly what it does. My wheelchair last month in July brought me to the Great Wall of China. And if my parents had listened to those doctors when we were first diagnosed, I was diagnosed later than Alba. We were 6 months old when she was diagnosed, and we were 10 months old when I was diagnosed. But the doctors were telling my parents, you know, in my sister's case, she'll never walk, she'll never talk. And they used the words, she will never Don't get your hopes up. Don't get your hopes up. They will never live a normal life. That normal is another problematic word for me. Because I will admit, my life's not normal, but I'm really proud of the fact that it's not normal. And I would bet that every single person in this room has a less than normal life. And that's a pretty great thing, I think. And so one of the stories that I want to tell you about is when we were really young, the first crazy radical thing that my parents did was they sent us away at 6 years old, just me and my twin sister, to a summer camp for children with all types of disabilities, to a sleepaway camp for 6 weeks. They're two most fragile children, as society saw us. And most people surrounding my parents at the time said, "You're completely insane. How could you do that? How could you let these random 18, 19, 20-year-old kids who have no training, you know, take care of your girls for 6 weeks?" And it was the most magical experience because I was around kids like me, kids that had all kinds of disabilities, so I felt safe, but I was also introduced to able-bodied people who didn't have disabilities, who were able to interact with us just in the same way that our families did. And we went to that camp year after year, and during our years at camp, we experienced everything you would imagine average little kids and then young adults would experience. I remember one counselor taking Alba out of her wheelchair and deciding that he wanted to roll with her in her arms. Like, he held her in his arms and he decided it would be cool to stand at the top of this grassy hill and hold her in his arms and roll down the hill, because he'd taken the time to get to know Alba and he realized she's really adventurous. She likes to do crazy shit, and I'm gonna help her do it. So she was rolling down grassy hills, and I was convincing the lifeguards to teach me a way that I could dive into the pool. So we figured out, because my balance is really crappy, that the best way would be for the lifeguard to hold me over the diving board and to let me bounce on it a couple of times. And then he literally just threw me into the pool. And it happened. And most people who would come to our visiting days, I'd be so excited for our parents to come and to show them new things that I was learning. But most people from the donors to the camp or other people that would come would look at some of these things and still be completely horrified. And the reason why they were horrified is because we're still seen in the eyes of not all, but most, as really fragile. And while I do want to acknowledge that there are some disabilities that, you know, make people have to consider certain health concerns, and you do have to be careful about certain things, the kids that worked with us, the young people, did learn about our different disabilities and what we could and couldn't do, and there were nurses and medical people on staff to guide them. But the best part about them, just like my family, was that they didn't limit us. So that experience growing up at camp enabled me to get to know people like me. And then my family enabled me to integrate into the rest of society. So I started out at a school just for kids with disabilities, and I left that school because they decided to tell my parents that Alba was too disabled. She can't talk. She can't go to this school. It was a school for children, just for children and young adults with disabilities. And my sister was too disabled. It wasn't about the teachers not understanding how to educate her. It was about her being too disabled to learn, which I always find very interesting. I think we live in a very ableist society, and I think the cool thing, I think we all always have to work. We're expected to work to fit into a society that wasn't built for us. And I think if more of us, more of you, my friends and my allies, think about what you can do to make your world more accessible to me, that would be fabulous, because I can't do it alone. I can't, and neither can all of us. There are about 54 million Americans, I believe, in the US who are considered disabled. And the definition of what's disabled, I wrote a dissertation last summer, and one thing I learned is it's really hard to define disability because it's such a broad ranging spectrum. So you can do a lot to help us be able to function better in a world that wasn't built for us, instead of always expecting us to conform to your world. And I always remember my mom telling me that story because the principal was so insistent that it was her lack of ability that was causing her not to be able to go to the school. So my mom naturally pulled me out of the school, and I ended up just by chance in a regular education classroom, which meant that I was in a class of 35 other kids doing the same, for the first time really, doing the same homework, same assignments, and same expectation. And then once my parents realized that I was succeeding in that way, they approached the Board of Education to integrate my twin sister into a mainstream classroom. And they said no pretty immediately. And so my parents launched, I was around 9 at the time, and my parents had by then launched a legal battle against the Board of Education to try to change this. And around this time, I got a really cool opportunity to go to the White House to participate in a conference called with the newly elected President Clinton. Literally 1 month after he got elected, he decided to bring a bunch of kids to the White House to talk to him about what we wanted to understand more, or what we were worried about in terms of our futures. We could really ask him anything we wanted to. So I have a little clip of what I decided to ask President Clinton at the time. So I'll let you see that.
Anastasia, you've had your hand up a lot. Maybe, Mr. President, you'd like to come and sit down,
Anastasia,
for a second. Excuse me for 1 sec, reaching over you here. Come and sit here, sir. Sarah, you come and sit here if you wouldn't. Let the President sit down, I think.
Okay.
I have a twin sister, and we go to the same school, but she can't speak. So because she can't speak, they put her in a special class. But she uses computers to speak, and I would like her to be in a regular class just like me.
Wow. And you think your sister could do just as well as you in a regular class?
Yes.
As long as she can use her computer. And her computer is on a little top, just like this, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you can put it on here, and you can put it on regular tables also, because you can carry it around. It's a little computer.
And she talks to you by using it?
Yeah.
Why do you think they put her in the special education class?
I think it's because she couldn't talk, and they thought, the principal thinks that she can't do it because she can't use her hands and she can't speak.
But you think that she could learn just as quickly if she were in a regular class?
Yes.
Have your parents asked the principal to put her in a regular class?
Yes.
And they said no?
The principal said no.
Well, you know, as president, I can't do anything about that except to speak about it. But I'll tell you this, I have a friend named Hamp Rasko, whose mother works for me here. And he's now 18 years old. He has cerebral palsy. And he doesn't speak quite as well as you, but he can probably speak a little more than your sister. And I have watched him go all the way through high school and graduate from high school and get his graduation ring. He lives out on his own now. And I'm going to do what I can to help people let all Americans go as far as they can. And I think young people who are working hard to prove they can do this kind of work ought to be given the chance to do it. And I think your sister should be given the chance to show whether she can work in the class or not. That's what you think, isn't it?
Yes.
You just wanted to have a chance to prove whether she can do it or not, right?
Yes.
And if she tried and she couldn't do it, then would you support her being in another class?
Yes.
So you just want your sister to have a chance?
Yes.
Good for you. Maybe she'll get it because we were here talking about this.
I have a feeling. Thanks, Anastasia, very much. Thank
you,
Mr. President.
Let's give her a hand. Wasn't that great? Yaskis. Thanks for sticking up for your sister. That's wonderful.
So he was right. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to speed through the rest of the story a little, but he was right. She got that chance as much as he said that day that he couldn't do very much himself directly to help. He found a way, and he and I became pen pals. I started writing to him as a 9-year-old, and he would write back every time. He wrote a handwritten letter to me telling me that he had asked some of his people in the administration to look into my sister's school situation. And by the next September, she was integrated. And after that, the people always ask me, what were the struggles after that? Or was it smooth sailing after that? No, that's not where the legal battles ended. My mom had to fight for a lot of additional accommodations and to level the playing field in the classroom. And to be honest, now having officially completed my graduate degree from the London School of Economics, I can tell you that I still fight those battles trying to get the people in education, whether we're talking about primary, secondary, or college or graduate school, a lot still needs to change in terms of thinking about how to educate, thinking outside of the box in terms of educating people like me and my twin sister. So that's a lot of what I do today. But another really important part of the story, and I feel like this is where all of you guys come in, and I guess I'll end on this note, is outside of my family, I went through a really awkward stage when I was, just like everybody else, when I was young and a teenager. My parents in our house had created a really safe space, but the world outside was very different. And I continued pushing myself to do things that scared me all the time. When I was 15, I showed up to this program for kids who'd done really well in high school so far and decided to take some advanced placement courses because I had a teacher that really believed in me. And he put a brochure on my desk one day that said Yale, Princeton, Brown, and a few others. And he said, you're gonna apply to this summer. And that summer, not because my family, but some friends changed my life that summer. And one of those friends is at Duke this year. His name is Jason. Some of you have probably met him. And so I thank the Duke for bringing us back together, because I met Jason at a time when I still believed, as hard as my parents had tried to work, that all people could see was my wheelchair. To the point where when Jason came up and approached me and said hi for the first time, I literally didn't know what to do, because it was the first time that someone who didn't have a disability, who wasn't a member of my family or a counselor at that summer camp, that had talked to me just like everyone else. And in my head, I was thinking, why isn't he weirded out by the wheelchair? Why isn't he being all awkward, right? And I remember not responding for the first few seconds, just because I was so caught up with the fact that he was completely different from me, and yet still talking to me. And I was in that program, I was the only student with a severe disability. And I look forward to a world where I'm no longer the lonely only. I've been the lonely only for a lot of the things that I've done in my life. And I think true progress will be measured not in the laws that we already have. Like, this year is a special year because it's the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. And those laws help, but when we go through our daily lives, we're not thinking about laws that are on the books. What matters is conversations like the ones we're getting to have this weekend. And Jason decided to have one conversation with me, and it changed my life. The things that he made me do that summer, I didn't have a reason to believe that I couldn't do them or that it would be different for me if I tried. But for some reason, I did believe. I did believe that I couldn't dance, for example, and he was the first one to show me that I could. So if there's any advice that I can give you to leave you with, I would say take the chances that scare you most, because I've gotten the most out of the things that I've been most terrified to try and do. And I've failed at some things I've tried to do. I got rejected from law school, every single one, 2 times running. I applied 1 year, got rejected, applied another year, got rejected. So you are going to fail, like a lot of other people have said this weekend. But you will gain the most from the biggest challenges in your life. I was terrified to be in China the whole time. The whole time I was terrified. But I knew that experience, just like every other one, would change my life. So do the things that scare you most. Cherish the 5-minute conversations that you have with people. Dance at every chance you get, and don't think about what people are thinking if they look at you, because they're really not looking at you, is what I've learned in my life. And so, thanks for having me.
This is for Anastasia. Can you tell us a little bit about what your sister's up to now, your twin sister?
Thank you for asking that, because I realized during the talk as always, but I don't leave enough time to touch on that. She ended up spending 4 years auditing classes at Queens College, and she didn't get a degree. That we had a team of people work with her to design a program that she could complete, so she focused most on art because she's an artist, a teaching artist really by profession now. And if you're interested in checking out her work, she does have a website. You can come to me and I can talk to you a little bit more about it if you're interested. But that's what she does now. She, again, we found a way to adapt the college experience for her so that she could get that while I was away at Georgetown. And now she is an artist. She paints at an art studio in New York City called Pure Vision Arts. And it's an art studio mostly for artists who are autistic. And she also docents, so she gives tours at museums in New York City, and she teaches art for kids with disabilities in the city. So she's doing so well.
Anastasia, what's next for you after school?
People ask me that question a lot. And one of the things that I forgot to mention in the speech, as always, you forget a bunch of things you want to say when you're up here. And one of the other guiding principles that helped me, or that I strive to do more, is to live spontaneously. Because another thing about having a disability is always having to plan. We have to plan pretty much everything all the time. So I'm actually kind of proud to sit up here and say that I'm not exactly sure what I'm doing next. I have a lot of dreams for the future. I might write a book at some point. I love to write. So I might go back to my academic roots at some point and tell my story on paper. That would be a lot of fun. I might go back to my roots in politics. I studied political science for my undergraduate degree, so there's a chance I may go back to do some political work. Or I have the option to continue pursuing my work in international human rights and women's rights and disability rights, and that's, I think, where I might go right now, but I'm not sure. And I'm kind of excited to say I'm not sure, because I have a lot of potential opportunities. And I think I'm just going to go with what feels right. And to be honest, I'm still figuring that out. That's part of what made me scared to come here at first, because I said to Duke, I said yes so quickly, and then 3 days later, I was like, oh no, what did I just get myself into? Everybody's gonna get up there and say what they're, talk about what they have already established. And another friend said the most miraculous thing to me before coming here. She said, just remember, you're going to the do lectures, not the done lectures. That's where I'm at. I'm excited to see what opportunities come my way and what's the next thing that I can say yes to.
Thank you so much. And Anastasia, I love that idea of do the thing that scares you the most. And I'm really interested in, for both of you, Frank also, what's the thing that scares you the most?
The thing that I guess I can still say it scares me. I think I'm still working toward being this, but I think I would still say sometimes just being okay with being me and always doing the work to remember that that's okay despite what anybody says, because I still encounter so often in my life people making judgments about me before they know who I am or before they know what I'm capable of. Like, I have a master's degree in human rights from the London School of Economics, and I have a resume that goes back to when I was 9 years old, and I really, really, really struggle to get opportunities to work and to get people to put their faith in me in the same way that they would someone who didn't have a disability. So I think the struggle to be me regardless of what's going on around me is still something that I work on and that I honestly deal with every day in everything that I do.